August 8, 1969, four people broke into a secluded house in the Hollywood Hills. One of the intruders announced, "I am the devil and I have come to do the devil's work." Number one, the Manson murders.
No case had a more prominent victims that were totally innocent, that were absolutely slaughtered by this cult element.
Charlie Manson was an ex-con, failed musician, and self-proclaimed prophet to a fanatical group of followers known as The Family.
Manson desperately wanted to be a rock star, hung out with the Beach Boys, cut a few songs.
Charles Manson was pissed off at the Beach Boys and their producer, Terry Melcher. Terry Melcher, the producer, cut Manson off because Manson was so crazy, and it enraged him because Manson was getting a taste of fame.
Manson called upon his followers to exact revenge. The only problem, they didn't know where to find Melcher.
He knew that Melcher no longer lived there at 10050 Cielo Drive, but he knew that somebody prominent lived there.
That prominent couple was director Roman Polanski and his wife, actress Sharon Tate. Tate starred in the film Valley of the Dolls. Polanski was working in London that summer and asked friends to stay with Sharon.
Manson wanted to commit some shocking murders.
Charles Manson sent family members Tex Watson, Susan Atkins, Patricia Krenwinkel, and Linda Kasabian on a mission.
As they were driving out from Spahn Ranch, he leaned in the car and said, "Leave a sign, something witchy."
In this group, he was God. He was mini God. He decided who lived, who died. He decided how the murders would take place.
The first to die was Stephen Parent, a recent high school grad who was visiting the Gardner.
Stephen Parent begged him, "Please, please don't kill me. Please don't do anything. I won't say anything." Watson shot him four times at point blank range.
Jay Sebring, a renowned Hollywood hairstylist, was next.
And Watson smashed him in the face with the gun and then shot him.
Wojtek Frykowski, a Polish actor and close friend to Polanski, was stabbed 51 times and shot twice. His head was partially caved in by the butt of a gun.
Watson then went over to help Patricia Krenwinkel stab Abigail Folger.
Abigail Folger, heiress to the Folger coffee fortune, bled to death, the result of 28 stab wounds.
And after they took care of her, Watson went back in the residence. Susan Atkins had Sharon Tate at knife point.
Sharon was 8 months pregnant.
Sharon was crying and begging and pleading. She said, "Look, please, please don't hurt me. All I want to do is have my baby. Please let me have my baby."
Sharon Tate had 16 stab wounds, and of those 16 stab wounds, only three of the stab wounds were considered fatal. Just simply one where the person was just stabbing indiscriminately.
Sharon's blood was found smeared on the front door, spelling out the word pig.
One common element in anybody that commits these types of crimes is to shock people, to shock the community, to create a sense of terror, and that somehow embraces them, makes them feel powerful.
Manson hoped to spark a race war and then rule over the post-apocalyptic world himself.
Charlie Manson's Helter Skelter was a war that the Manson family were going to start between the blacks and the whites. Manson was going to jumpstart this war by making it appear like black people had done these murders.
The next night, members of the family found two more victims, a Los Angeles couple, the LaBiancas.
The LaBianca killings the next night was again, I believe, a matter of convenience to kill them. It was just by chance, simply by chance.
The killers used a fork to carve "war" into one of the bodies. The city of Los Angeles was in a state of shock.
People started locking their doors, locking their windows. That was the only subject people were talking about, was these mass murderers who were out there killing and brutalizing people.
It was a completely random situation, which is why it was so scary. It's why all of LA went crazy then, because it was like, oh my gosh, so who would kill these people? And in such a brutal way.
Loose talk by several Manson family members led to their eventual arrest. On January 15, 1971, a jury found Charles Manson, Patricia Krenwinkel, Susan Atkins, and Leslie Van Houten each guilty of murder and conspiracy to commit murder. Charles Tex Watson was found guilty of the same crimes at a later trial.
One of the most famous misconceptions about this group of murders is that Charlie Manson had blood on his hands, and it's not true. Charlie Manson never actually killed anyone of those seven victims.
Charles Manson has been up for parole 11 times. Each time, he has been denied.
Over the past three decades, Charles Manson has become almost a symbol of what ultimate darkness and evil represent.
These aren't people you would have initially thought of to be such cold-blooded murderers. That in itself is pretty darn scary.
These are the people we know. The famous, the beautiful, the powerful. Gone, but never forgotten.
We are rolling.
In a town of 1,000 manufactured deaths, it is the real stories of tragedy that grip us still.